Welcome, welcome, welcome to another episode of the Pixelated Sausage Show. Hi. How are y'all doing? If you're watching the video version, you may have seen, that I have decided to go back to the old camera ways entirely. I may still look at the camera every now and again like this, but this is just more comfortable for me. And when I'm not talking to other people on a call or whatever, I don't feel as obligated to... Do you want me looking in your soul as I'm talking? Do you really? Or do you just want to come along for the ride? Emphasis on the... along. But... yeah. We don't need that. We're just here to listen and have a good time and all that jazz. It's been a hectic week and change these past few weeks. Doing the whole streamer thing, then changing that, and I am hopefully going to get the first episode of Attack the Backlog version 2.0 out this Friday. But I'm still thinking about and trying to figure out how I want to do scheduling and if I want to be all dumb about it with some of the stuff and put out episodes a little bit early for all the shows on Patreon as a nice little perk that doesn't really matter but may be something that those people enjoy, just the audio versions. I don't know how much people actually care about that as a perk with Patreons and all of that. But I've just been dabbling with a lot of stuff. Dealing with personal life things and all that jazz. My dad is fairly back to normal ever since his stroke, that is. But there are still lingering things that only I really notice that aren't, hey, this'll change, or this is a bad thing. It's just, oh, this is different now. And I do have to make sure he always takes his pill still, because he will forget. Which sometimes is annoying, because it's such an easy thing for him to do. But he won't do it, regardless of all the alarms I've set up, because he's watching a TV show, or he's watching a movie. He's like, oh, I'll do it after this scene. I'll do it when the episode's over. Just fucking pause it. My God. It's so difficult for him. He can't do it. He can't just take the minute to pause whatever he's watching, because that's all he's ever doing. He's not working on this or that. He's just watching a movie or a show. Just pause it. For the love of God. Put my mind at ease a little bit. But enough about that. Has there been news? Probably. Do I know what it is? I don't know. I guess the PS5 Pro is the big news that officially leaked or was leaked and then substantiated by someone who was more credible, and then Sony just came out and confirmed it. Maybe. Either way, I don't really care. It's a new PS5. I'm most curious about the cost, what they're going to charge for it. And if it will be a hybrid console like the slim PS5, or if it's just going to have... I'm curious, will it be able to... Is it going to come with a disk drive fixed? And it's only going to be one SKU? Or is it going to be digital only? Or is it going to be a hybrid thing where you can buy a disk drive for it? And if you can, if it is the hybrid, format, it would have to be. There's no way they would have two SKUs of disk drives, one for the Slim and one for the Pro. So it would have to be somewhat in the same form factor. If it was, that would be the dumbest thing in the world. If it was like the Slim, in which you could have a digital version if you wanted, but if you wanted to attach a disk drive, you could, and it was a separate disk drive. Both in terms of the form or the build, the design of it, and also maybe it's a slightly more powerful drive. There's no way. But where there is a no way, there's a way. And that way is in the games I've been playing, which include Cartel Tycoon, Highwater, Slave Zero X, Astebros, Cybertrash, STATYX, and Cat and the Ghostly Road. And we're going to look at some DMs I got on Discord first, because that's great for podcasting. I'm not reading any of these. But they're about Madam Web, which I watched. And that is a really stupid movie. A really, really, really stupid movie. That I quite enjoyed for its stupidity. It has a lot of... It just feels like an incredibly lazy... Nobody really wanted to make this movie, but... Okay, let's just do this. We don't have any real excitement over it, which you can see in the performances and in the script and the writing and the filmmaking. It's just the most meh across the board movie with a lot of great references to Spider-Man that aren't direct references because they don't want to do it or they want to be cheeky about it, which I felt right from the start when you realize Dakota Johnson's character, which I don't know shit about Spider-Man lore or any of this stuff and how accurate it is or whatever, but I didn't realize Ben Parker was going to be in the movie and that Ben Parker was played by Adam Scott and he was her paramedic partner. And that was okay. But my favorite, probably, reference is near the end when they do the with great power comes great responsibility. But instead of putting it that way, instead of wording it that way, it's something along the lines of, if you take on the responsibility, great power will come. It's like, very nice, you stupid idiots. What a dumb, dumb, stupid movie. Do I think you would like it? The grand you? Probably not. But I enjoyed it. It's not the same kind of enjoyment I get out of something like Venom, where I think there are enjoyable, legitimately enjoyable parts of it. This is just, I like stupid shit. This is really stupid. I can appreciate that stupidity. But if you can't appreciate ridiculous stupidity, and especially if you take Spider-Man very serious, you're not going to have a good time. The kids are stupid. It's all stupid. What a stupid, stupid movie and a stupid, stupid story. And her... Because I'm assuming... Is her character name Madam Web? Is that who she is? Dakota Johnson's character? But I'm guessing that it's part of her character that something happens to her that makes her go blind. And she goes blind at the end. I'm guessing she's blind. And her blind sunglasses are so fucking dumb looking. But then they... I can't remember if it was live action or some kind of visual thing. You see what she would look like or what she looks like in the suit. And that looked much better. But her blind glasses... Like, who picked these? Who? Like, can't you do anything right? It's so stupid. But what's not stupid, but also not good, is Cartel Tycoon, the first game to talk about. And I'm going to do the thing I've done a few times I'm going to try and do this every episode now, but just go to the Steam page and read the little blurb at the very top and then talk about the game. Cartel Tycoon is a survival business sim inspired by the 80s and 90s narco trade. Expand and conquer, fight off rival thugs, and evade the authorities. Earn people's loyalty and strive to overcome the doomed fate of a power-hungry drug lord. So I play this on the Xbox, and I didn't even get through the tutorial. I found the UI and the controls incredibly clunky. The tutorial didn't do the greatest job of onboarding new players. I like the look of it. I do like it thematically, but I don't think it did a great job of gamifying the theme in an enjoyable way, which may be in large part because of the clunky nature of it overall. The narrative bits, because there are three different modes. There's a story-ish mode, a sandbox mode, and a survival mode. And the survival mode sounds like it would be the most interesting in a rogue-like-ish type of format, if you got the mechanics down. But I don't. The thing about it mechanically is that while sure, in many cases, I find games of this nature where you are managing a small little city, building buildings, collecting resources, connecting buildings with roads, and creating this infrastructure that is your Cartel Tycoon in this case. Well, I find a lot of them to be clunky with a gamepad. Some manage to make them work. I usually assume, having not the ability to check firsthand in most cases, unless games are Windows and Xbox, because I'm not going to buy a game on Steam or whatever if I don't own it that way. I usually say, yeah, this is not feeling great on gamepad, but I think it would feel pretty good on mouse and keyboard. I don't think that would be the case with Cartel Tycoon. I think it would still be pretty clunky and frustrating to control that way. It would be better, absolutely, but I don't think that would make up for or fix the inherent clunkiness of the game. There are some, not so much translation, the story, when you have back and forth dialogue with characters, that's all grammatically fine, but in the subtitles for the few cutscenes here and there, the subtitles have messed up right from the bat. They have typos like spelling sure, like the audio company, like this microphone that I'm speaking in right now. It's a sure. And that's how they spell sure. S-H-U-R-E. Which I found very weird, and there was some formatting issues, but it's not so much that you can't understand what they're saying. You know what they're saying. It's just, oh, that's not right. But it was just incredibly clunky and cumbersome trying to play the game. And when I'm fighting against the controls, it doesn't matter what the underlying game is, because I can't even get past actually controlling it. Will it get updated? Probably not. And even if it was, like I said, I don't think it does as much as it could with the theme from what I've played. Again, because it's such a chore to play and so frustrating, I didn't even get through the entire tutorial. So there might be a lot more there, but I'm not going to get there because I just don't enjoy actually playing the game. That just bugged the crap out of me, which is disappointing. That is Cartel Tycoon, though. Next is Highwater, which I guess was originally a Netflix exclusive. And that might be why it's the way it is, which I'll get to shortly. But Highwater is, as in the little blurb on Steam, Earth has flooded and the planet is doomed, but there's still time to enjoy the view. Guide Nikos and friends through the flooded world of Highwater and beyond in this story-driven adventure game where they'll have to fight for their chance to escape. So this is a game where you are thrown into this post-apocalyptic version of the world, essentially, where global warming has kicked in and the world has flooded. It's very, very bright and colorful, so it's not drab and dreary like a lot of post-apocalyptic worlds. But the thing I was hoping from this game and I was expecting, which was the ability to explore the environment and discover new areas, little off the beaten path sections where I might find some cool items or whatever. I felt like I would be able to have a more organic experience in this world, which would also have a narrative aspect, but I could explore it as well. That's not there. It is very linear with occasional little tiny areas that you can go and maybe find a newspaper with a headline that gives you some flavor to the world, or a consumable you'll be able to use in the turn-based combat of the game, which is very, very basic and seems to be emphasizing the environment and using it to win fights in more of a puzzly way than a straight combat sense, in that I've been already in multiple fights where it's not that I can use the environment to my advantage, but that I literally can't win a fight unless I do this very specific thing, which is set up in the small space that the fight is taking place in. So I don't even feel like I'm utilizing much strategy or much thought of my own. I'm just looking at the way this fight has been set up and saying, okay, well, clearly to win this fight, I have to go do this. So I'm going to go do that. Oh, okay, that worked. Cool. The turn-based mechanics and all that are very, very simple. Not a lot of depth to it. You just have your basic attacks and end turns and nothing too crazy going on there. And then the story itself wasn't doing much to grab me, with a lot of characters spouting a bunch of stuff that wasn't engaging. But the real issue for me was that lack of exploration. I wanted this world to feel alive and for me to feel the freedom to explore, because it is a pretty world, but it's just so fucking empty and boring. And then when the combat is also dull and feels very light on both strategy and mechanics, I don't see what is here to draw me in and make me want to keep playing, and the story isn't doing it. And I wonder if the fact that it was originally a Netflix game, and I think Netflix now gives you the ability to play the games on PC, but for the longest time was mobile only. I wonder if that aspect is why it feels as simple as it does, because you're not going to want overly complicated mechanics or any of that kind of stuff with a game that was only for a time available via Netflix. Because who's really playing Netflix games anyway? I've never done it. I don't know a single other person who has either. And I love Into the Breach, which I think you can still only get on mobile via Netflix. And I've never done it. I'm not going to do it. I would love to play it on mobile, Let me buy it. I want to buy your game again anyway, so just let me buy it. I don't want to do this Netflix shit. But yeah, Highwater was pretty disappointing in the sense that I really wanted to explore this world. But there's nothing to explore. And the characters are nothing. It's just nothing, nothing, nothing. Then Slave Zero X is a stylish 2.5D character action game set in the biopunk world of Slave Zero, 1999. I guess there was a game called Slave Zero. Run and slash your way through a dystopian future in this character action game, which will resonate with fans of Devil May Cry, Strider, and Guilty Gear. Okay, if you say so. So this is a sort of side-scrolling action game that feels kind of like a beat-em-up from the 16-bit era, PlayStation 1 era. It has some nice visuals to it. And when you get into combat with enemies, it feels less like a beat-em-up and more like a fighter. So I guess that's kind of where the Guilty Gear fits in. It reminds me a lot visually of, and the way the fighting feels, of stuff like Fatal Fury. So a lot of the, what are they? Arc System, Neo Geo, whatever. A lot of those games. Fatal Fury. What is Fatal Fury? What is the developer / publisher of that? Can't remember. But the combat feels very light. There's not a lot of weight to it. When enemies, you can juggle them a little, but when they hit the ground, you can't attack them or do any damage to them, which I found a little frustrating. While it looks nice, I don't think it feels all that great. It does some cool stuff with, not perspective, but you're fighting in these 3D worlds while on this 2D plane. So it'll, when you turn around corners, you'll have a little camera thing. And it the presentation is pretty solid. The actual gameplay, from what I've played, it's nowhere near as complicated, or there's nowhere near as much depth as something like a Devil May Cry. It's nowhere near as satisfying. It's not as flashy. It's not as fun. It's not as exciting. It's way more DMC light, if anything. But it wasn't super fun to play. It felt very hack and slashy. And being on a 2D plane without the ability to go up and down, so it's not a 2D 2.5 plane, you're just going right. You're just going right. And sometimes enemies will come from the left, so you'll be in these fight sections that are the most Devil May Cry-ish, in that you'll get to an area, you can't progress any further, and enemies will come from both sides, and then you fight them off, try to build combos, and then you'll get scored after those sections. And after a level finishes, you'll get a cumulative score. But despite getting an A in the first area, for instance, I didn't feel like I gave an A performance, but apparently it was A worthy. But it didn't do all that much for me. Nice look, nice presentation, dull gameplay. Then Astebros is a really cool retro game that bums me out. But first, the description. Choose your hero among three different characters and go through procedural dungeons to eliminate your formidable opponents. The structure of the game is a 2D side-scrolling action game where you fight in these small little rooms and you're progressing in a very rogue-like way, very much so like Rogue Legacy, for instance. So you'll be in a small little square rectangle space, and then when you clear it out, there'll be pathways that open, either one to your, depending on how you entered a room,
above you, below you, on the sides. And you're just progressing through these areas until you find the boss, and then you fight the boss. And the first boss in the first area was very, very easy. And you have this little overworld map that allows you to go to different areas and take them on. They'll have difficulty ratings. And it feels really good. It looks really good. It again has a really good presentation style. 16-bit-ish pixel art. And it feels really good. I loved playing it. I loved the sound effects, the enemy animations, your character animation, all great. The enemy behavior, the way certain ones attack, was fun. They had some fun things, like a pig who would charge at you and do a little die. Like, it was dripping inside and felt like a retro game that knew, you know what you're doing. Solid, satisfying double jump, dash. The three characters are, I believe, a mage and then a melee focused sword wielder and a ranger type with a bow and arrow and all that. But the problem is, this, I'm assuming that other game I talked about before, it was also Pixel Heart published. It's a retro game that does the whole 4:3 aspect ratio thing, and you can turn on some filters, which are whatever, leave them all off, I'd recommend. But it does the same border shit with the name of the game on the sides, and this is especially ugly. There's not even any real effort put into it and making some kind of stylish or whatever. But you can't turn it off. You can't just say, I want black borders. Stop it. Again, if you have a display that is susceptible to burn-in, well, fuck you then, I guess. Though at this point, I don't know. People are playing on old displays anyway, but I'm not sure if burn-in has become less of an issue with all modern displays, but if you have one from a handful of years ago, I think on the LG side especially, they had a lot of issues. It's just, one, your border is ugly. I don't like looking at it. Two, just give me the option to turn it off. What the fuck? You put in all these stupid filters. Are you so proud of your border? You made a really good game that I really enjoy. I like the structure. I like the feel. I like the look. I like the audio. I like so much of it. Turn that shit off, though. So if you're not concerned about burning or anything like that, I'd recommend checking it out from what I played. But I don't. I just, the border thing is so frustrating. Then in similar fashion, we have Cybertrash STATYX, and that's Cybertrash, and then in all caps, STATYX, is a 2D action platformer with elements of a tactical and set in a cyberpunk world. What? Is a 2D action platformer with elements of a tactical, all right, and set in a cyberpunk world. Run, jump, slide, and destroy enemies to gain experience points for upgrading your character, Jeanette. I like the look of this. It has kind of a GBA, Game Boy Advance, look to it, which I like. Nice bits of color. The problem, though, is that it doesn't feel super responsive. So when I'm navigating the space and utilizing the slide, which you have to do a lot, because the slide allows you to get under small spaces, of course, or under small whatever in gaps. You also use it pre-jump to jump higher, jump further. So you have to use it a lot. And there are plenty of times where I am near the edge of something and I want to slide and then do a jump to reach a certain spot. And there's just something off about the input lag or whatever, so that I'll end up not hitting that jump and I fall off and then I have to redo it. And it became frustrating, and it forced me to do and control the game, always thinking a little bit early, so I never want to take any huge risk. I'm always concerned that if I try to be too close with this, I'm gonna miss it. So let me just put in my own internal reverse delay, whatever. And that made the whole thing a little bit frustrating, but it was okay. It felt good otherwise. You have a base pistol, but then you can pick up heavy weapons and light weapons while you're going through levels. It's all level based. And they will have limited ammunition, all the weapons you pick up, but they feel pretty good. The enemies are pretty easy to deal with. Wasn't super challenging though. It just felt slightly off. In large part because of that lack of responsiveness. But I'm gonna play a little bit more and see if I get used to it or what, because there's potential there, but it just, coming off of especially something like Astebros, which felt really tight and very good, Cybertrash maybe not the best ape. It didn't feel trashy, it just felt subpar. But what was the trashiest, not to be mean or anything, of the bunch, was the last game, which is Cat and Ghostly Road, which is an atmospheric point-and-click quest in which you play as a white cat. You have to go on a dangerous journey to the world of ghosts and demons. Not all things are what they seem. Is how they ended that. This is a point-and-click adventure. You play a white cat, as it said in the description, who opens the game by walking until they can't. They run out of energy, can't walk anymore, and then they're saved by this old gentleman who becomes sick after being cursed or something by an evil spirit, and then you have to go and try and save him and help him. You go into these other worlds through his paintings. At least that's the first thing you do. And I found it very quickly to become confusing, with me not knowing what the hell it wanted me to do. There were multiple points very early on where I wasn't sure what it wanted me to do. And I didn't care about the story. The art, which I think for me at least is often one of the biggest selling points to games like this, because I don't find the gameplay incredibly engaging, where they're mostly just here, click all, you're on a screen, click everywhere. And in some of the games, they'll allow you to press a button that'll show you all the interactable objects, so you don't even have to really think about what you may or may not be able to click on. Just okay, I'm gonna click on everything, and then eventually I'm gonna have to figure out some kind of obtuse interaction. I'm gonna have to combine some two items that don't make sense and then do something with them that also doesn't make sense. Great puzzle design, but I'm doing it all because you either have a really, really good story, really great characters, or I love the art so much. I always bring up, it was Machinerium, is that the name of it, as one of the ones I really liked, not because I thought the puzzles were great. I thought they were fine. They didn't impede my ability to enjoy what I enjoyed of that game, which was the art. I fucking adore the art in Machinarium. And that reminds me, I still need to play their other games. I think there was something Botany Manor, or that's a new game, I think. Botany Gar. There's something else they put out. Maybe two games at this point. But that's usually the solo point, and I don't really like the art here. The story hasn't grabbed me. As the cat, you're able to see the spirit world, so you can switch that on and off. And when I got to the first spirit world with the crane, I went everywhere I could go, interacted with everything I could interact with as far as I could tell. And I got to a point where I needed to play these drums to get the crane to release itself or whatever, the crane's evil spirit. And part of that process involved getting this beehive, this wasp hive actually, and then shoving the wasp in the drum that was broken, but I needed to find a way to fix it so that the wasp wouldn't escape when I played it. I didn't know what to do to fix that. And there was a fish that wanted me to eat it. And I was like, I don't want to eat you. And then I didn't know what to do with that. I'm just an idiot. Let's just leave it at that. I'm an idiot. Maybe you'll like it because you're not an idiot like me. But I was just annoyed by it. So that is what it is. I'm an idiot. I think that's something we can all agree on. But that is it. That is all for what I've been playing and all that good jazz. So that will do it for this year episode of the Pixelated Sausage Show. Once again, I am Marcus Jones. Y'all can find me pretty much everywhere at PX Sausage. If you enjoy this year's show or any of the stuff I do and what have you, you can support me and my nonsense over at patreon.com/PXS. In addition to the Patreon, you can find links to the site, the Discord, the YouTube, and so much more over at pxsausage.com. But that is it. That is all. As always, thank you for watching or listening. I hope you enjoyed this here episode, and I hope you have both a wonderful rest of your day, a lovely rest of your week, and a wonderful weekend. But for now, adios, arrivederci. Bye.
It's go time, go daddy. It's go time, go daddy.